of how we think the solar system and the planets formed is that the water ice started to cluster together, trapping heavy elements, forming something called icy planetesimals. These are, if you will, really tiny little dirty ice balls. And when Jupiter starts to come together, the growing theory among most models is that as it brings in this other leftover debris, it brought in a bunch of these icy planetesimals. Now, the icy planetesimals may have come from our solar system or maybe came from a neighboring interstellar cloud as well. Nobody really knows. But this is sort of the theory of how Jupiter got enriched. And we knew Jupiter was enriched in these heavy elements. In fact, that was the reason that we sent Galileo probe there. Galileo dropped a probe into the atmosphere to look at the differences in those heavy elements. And what it came back with was they were all enriched about the same, which was a puzzle. In fact, with that one measurement, all the theories of how planets were made kind of went out the window. And what you were left with is, okay, so the volatility or how easy these things get trapped inside the ice doesn't seem to matter. They all got trapped the same enrichment, even though the abundances of these things in the sun and in the interstellar space is very different. So we were left with a puzzle. This ties to us directly because the stuff that Jupiter's enriched in, these heavy elements, everything heavier than helium, is what we're made out of. It's what the Earth's made out of. It's what all life is made out of. We're trying to figure out what that history was early in the solar system of how these things got into Jupiter and how the planets got more of them than the sun did, because it obviously led to us. Now, as far as different abundances of water goes, there are different models. And because Galileo probe was unable to get a correct or at least a confident measurement of the water abundance in Jupiter, that has become a free variable in the models. And the models to develop or to form Jupiter have quite a bit of variety in how much water they have in Jupiter, depending on which model you look at. And so the water measurement is a discriminator among these theories and these models and will constrain which models move forward and which ones don't. And that's really the trick to it. Now, if there's a lot of water, it means one thing. Maybe Jupiter formed further out and migrated in. If there's less water, it may have moved closer. But these are, you know, I don't want to dwell too much on the different models out there because they may come and go. The important thing is that the water abundance is the discriminator among these models, which is why it is so important for us to measure.
Okay, additional questions from Houston.
Hi, this is Robert Perlman with CollectSpace.com with a question and a follow-up for Dr. Scott Bolton. You sort of touched on this in your last reply, but can you talk a little bit about how this mission, its objectives and science were built off of what was learned with the prior missions that have gone to Jupiter, the flybys by Pioneer and Voyager and then Galileo?
Yeah, I can touch on that. I mean, With Pioneer and Voyager, we learned a great deal. They were, like reconnaissance missions, our first close-up looks at these giant planets. They told us about the gravity field a little bit. They certainly piqued our interest, and we learned quite a bit about composition. So we knew some things were enriched at Jupiter. We knew other things weren't. And we knew that its bulk composition was mostly hydrogen and helium, which is very similar to the sun and similar to these interstellar clouds. So that kind of laid the groundwork. Galileo probe went in and measured the rest of these elements like I had just gone through. And most people think that we were maybe unlucky at the way Galileo probe went in, that it went into something called a hot spot, sort of the Sahara Desert of Jupiter. So when you saw my image from Cassini of Jupiter, you see that it's full of stripes and zones and belts, lots of colors, lots of spots. Each one maybe is a little kind of storm or some meteorological feature. And we know from looking at images of Jupiter from the time Galileo probe went in that it went into one of these little spots that was colored a little different, a little warmer. Most people think this represents the Sahara Desert of Jupiter. We don't really know that, but it's possible. What we do know is that the water was depleted where we went in. We also know that our measurement of water wasn't complete because as the probe dropped down, It was aimed or designed to work to 20 bars pressure. One bar of pressure is what the pressure is on our surface at sea level. So it was designed to work at 20 bars pressure. It lasted to 22 bars, so it surpassed its requirements there. But what we saw was the water abundance was still increasing at the time the probe stopped working. So we know we never got to the well-mixed region. This is in contrast to the other elements that we measured, where we reached a point where they were well mixed, and we knew that we were getting a good global measurement. So the extension to Jupiter, or to Juno, where we were looking for the water, was a natural extension to follow on to Galileo probe. We also had learned from Hubble telescope, from Ulysses, you know, we look at the composition of the sun, we look at the composition of the interstellar clouds, we look at the isotopes, and we start to put together the picture of how Jupiter formed or how it's similar or different than the sun. Galileo also provided some very important measurements on the gravity field, but it didn't get close enough to get the really high-order gravity field measurements to tell us about whether there's a core of heavy elements in the center or to tell us something about how Jupiter's structured inside. Same thing with the magnetic field. Galileo orbited around the equator. It got very good measurements. It was also further away than we are. It was mostly orbiting out at Europa's distance or greater. So it was doing a good job getting the magnetospheric measurements, but it was not looking at the internal magnetic field. We go in close and we look at the internal magnetic field, and in fact, we'll probably get the best view and maybe understand dynamos better than we can even look at from the Earth. And so we're building on Galileo's knowledge, basically, and its discoveries, but we're extending those by going into the polar orbit, so we get all of magnetic and gravity field, and we're extending those by going much, much closer and enabling a better measurement.
You have a follow-up?
Thanks. And just from a trivia standpoint, I know prior PIs have put on some commemorative items on their spacecraft. I think New Horizons carried a Florida quarter and other items. Was anything stowed aboard Juno as a commemorative of your team or of the mission?
Nobody offered me a quarter. we have a couple of things. I think we'll be doing an announcement later on those. I don't know exactly. One of the things we did was we put on something to commemorate the loss of some of the people that were working on it. But we had some other things, and I think that'll be done later.
And we have one more question from Houston, and then we'll come back here.
Yeah, hi. It's Bill Harwood. One last very quick question. You know, I can't even visualize a couple of megabars, much less 40. When you say rock at the core, possibly, is it really rock like I would envision rock under those kind of pressures, or is it something really different like metallic hydrogen? I mean, I just can't visualize it. Thanks.
It's very different, and I hesitate every time I say the word rock because people think it's like a rock like we think of, and it's not. A better phrase that I usually use is a core of heavy elements, because I don't really know what that is like. I have just as much trouble picturing 40 megabars as you do. I know that it's very different than the material that we have on the Earth, and even the metallic hydrogen is very, very strange behavior fluid. And the way they learn about this stuff is these people that study fusion reactions. They have a little pellet, deuterium or something, and they blast it. And for a split second, it goes under incredibly high pressure. And so while there's scientists around trying to understand the fusion reaction, there's a bunch of fundamental physicists around there trying to understand what's called the equation of state. What is the behavior of hydrogen at incredibly high pressure? And so it's a very strange material. Whatever is in the center of Jupiter is not like what we have on the Earth.
Okay, let's come back. And Todd, I think you have a question.
I do. Todd Halverson of Florida Today, for whoever wants to field it. Would you have met your schedule had you gone with RTG technology? And I assume from new development, you're talking about new development of advanced RTGs that are better and more efficient than the ones that flew on Galileo and such. And I'm also wondering if you could tell us how much safer this vehicle is, given the probably highly unlikely possibility of a inadvertent reentry on the Earth flyby?
I'll give that to you. I can say that I think the risk was less because we went with solar arrays. I think it's a hard question to say exactly what would have happened if we had been delayed had we gone with RTGs, because the RTGs were not developed on in the schedule that we would have needed. But at the same time, because we had proposed solar arrays, it may be that the reason to develop those also was partially went away. And so I don't know how that's connected, and maybe Jim can address that.
Well, as I alluded to earlier, at the time we were developing with Department of Energy a new capability. It was a multi-mission radioisotope power system called an MMRTG, and that's flying on MSL. So relative to the mission choices that Scott made, and he decided that he could do the mission without it, the key element with the science and how he was making the measurements actually won the day and allowed the selection to proceed with Scott versus any power system or any other capability like that. So it was an option. He chose not to use it. Had he chose that, as you are asking the question, does that change the mission architecture in terms of having a different gravity assist or a different way? And there are many ways to get to Jupiter. And they would study that, and it would be a new mission, a different mission than it is now. So those are all elements of going through a major part of the study, of structures and processes that get them out to Jupiter. Now, the MMRTG is such that one of them on MSL generates about 110 watts. So if he had an architecture and he needed 400 watts, then we're talking about four MMRTGs at this stage. But once again, that would be a different mission than he's flying.
Okay, we've got just a couple of minutes left. Stephen, if you have one.
Hi, thanks. Stephen Clark, Spaceflight Now. I was just wondering, how did you guys settle on a spinning spacecraft? Is that science-driven, or is it thermal, or because of the solar rays?
That was first put together mainly science-driven. We probably could have gone three-axis stabilized, but this enabled us to obtain science measurements in a convenient way, and at the same time gave us the natural stability. But we probably could have made it work with three-axis stabilized, but it might have been more complicated operations.
And one for Jan. Do you need access to the spacecraft between now and launch to do any final work, and how many margin or contingency days do you have left for the 5th?
We do have access to the spacecraft. There are doors that are designed into the payload fairing and levels out at the vertical integration facility, where we can get in and do any inspections, remove before flight items, put on any add before flight items, that sort of thing. So we do have that planned. It's in the schedule, and we have the access that we need. As far as the schedule is concerned, we're on schedule using primarily prime shift days between now and August 5th. We will work Saturday and Sunday, but we are not currently using off shift or third shift to be ready on time.
All right, that's all we have time for. We'd like to draw your attention to two websites where you can get more information on Juno. The first one is www.nasa.gov/Juno. And the second one is missionjuno.swri.edu. And so that will conclude our Juno mission briefing. Thank you very much.